looks good. You tell me, are you transitioned? What's up, potheads and political junkies? Are we on? Can you hear us? Are we broadcasting? Can you see us? I think that it is working. If you guys are in the chat, let us know what's up. Hi, girl from Norway. You can hear me loud and clear? My little hand mic here? All right. Well, as you can see, we're in a different location. There's some beautiful foliage outside there. It's the trees in the third floor of the Vapor Lounge creeping through the window. And it's very nice up here. We're taking a sort of casual day today. I have the sniffles. I'm feeling a little sick. And we just wanted to hang out. And we wanted to smoke out of our brand new friend. And I'm with Mel here. Say hi to Melly first.
Hey, guys.
There is quite the lag, though, that I'm seeing. So if you guys tell me if it's too choppy out there or if there's any problems at all. I'm with Mel Hempseed here.
Hey, Mac. Hey, guys.
And Mel, you were sad because, and I was sad, because we had a friend, we lost our friend, Princess, recently.
Yeah, that was a really sad, sad day.
It was, and actually, we're going to bring Marius on to tell the story of how that happened in just a little bit here, but we wanted to show you, we went down to a local, it is a redhead, went down to a local bong shelter and just happened to find what is Princess's sister, definitely in the family.
Very close.
She's very, very close. It's 4 years old. It's a high guy. And if you remember Princess, you know she had red lips. A red lip on the top anyway.
Sexy and curves.
This one is a very slightly different. It has four little comets here shooting around it. And that's about the only difference. Besides that, she looks nearly identical. And high guy.
Yeah, the other ball.
4 year old ball. That's right. One for each year, I guess. It's like she's like a ladybug. And yeah, so this bong probably is about 4 years old. They said at Puff, I think. And they said that they said they had two. They had another one that was a yellow top. It had a very small bowl on the bottom, though. I wasn't a huge fan. But these are the only like it left in Vancouver. I don't think they have them anywhere else. And of course, High Guy stopped making these bongs about a couple years ago because they moved their factory to China now, I guess, and they're not even making these at all. So these three-footers, you can't get them. So if this one goes...
Last of their kind.
That's going to be the end of it. That'll be the last one, I guess. But so, this is what I wanted to do. I wanted to have you folks out there who are watching in the chat actually name this bong, name her. So we want a female name, and the last bong was named... Pardon me, I might be coughing in the microphone because I'm very colded up. But, yeah, we want you guys to name her. We kind of were thinking of a royal type of name,
yeah.
Maybe. But what we'll do is we'll let you guys send a bunch of names at us. We'll keep watching the chat and write down a bunch of them, go through them, and we'll pick the one we like the best. And then whichever one we do like the best, whoever came up with it will get some sort of a prize. Now, Jody, we were talking about a prize. What do you think we should give away, a Pot TV shirt? Or something else? I don't know. What would you guys like? I thought a small piece of glass, but we don't actually send glass through the mail to the States. So if you're Canadian, maybe.
Bless you.
Oh, that's not very good. I need Kleenex. Oh, I'm all snotted up now. Let's do that live on the air. I should just spray it right at the camera. Anybody got some Kleenex? Woo! So, don't lean too close to the screen or you might get sick. What's that, Marijuana Man? Ah, Duchess. Now, we did have another... Somebody else suggest Duchess as well.
Ron said
Chronicity. Ah, Chronicity. Clever, Rom. Yeah, we did. We like Duchess a lot, actually. I noticed somebody said Empress out there. Shiva's pretty good. Wow, there's a lot here. So, I don't know. Keep sending. Maybe we should have somebody write them down or something. I could write some down. So far... I'll just keep watching. I like Angel. Yeah, there's a lot of good ones. So it's going to be up to me and Mel in the end. Because originally, Mel, why don't you talk a little bit about Princess and where you got Princess from in the first place? Because you gave Princess to me when you moved to Toronto. So here's the microphone.
Originally, when I first moved to Vancouver back in 2009, Jodie had the most amazing bong that was pretty much identical to this one, but it had a blue lip at the very top. And I told myself, one day I'm going to own a bong like that. And I really, really, really wanted it. And a friend of a friend actually sold me the bong for probably $80 or something. Bless you. Because he knew that I wanted it so bad and everything. I had that bong for probably a good year, and I slung it on my back every day to work and back. And when Jer first came around, I saw him, and I was told to go introduce him to Mark, and he was in here for the assistant editor position for an interview. So I brought him downstairs, and I introduced him to Mark, and afterwards he came back upstairs, and this is when we had the lounge in the main floor down at the CCHQ. And, I offered him a huge toke off of the bong, and he was slightly intimidated, but, you know, I told him he can do it, he can rock it, just wrap his lips around it and suck. And then he got the job, obviously, and ever since then, it was kind of our tradition. He used to be at work all the time, super early, at 11, and I would get him super stoned, and it was a daily routine up until Mark told me I wasn't allowed to come into the office until 5 and get him stoned, because I was getting him too stoned throughout too the early. Day. He wouldn't work. He was just too stoned throughout the day. So.
Yes, it's true. And so eventually you ended up going to Toronto.
Yeah, I ended up working at Vapor Central for a couple of months and moved back home to Toronto, and I didn't see that there was any possible way to ship a bong that big or carry a bong that big on my flight or anything, so decided to pass it off to a very good friend who would take very good care of her. So.
Lungzilla, some of the names coming in. The Queen. Who else? Bongzilla, of course. Frozen Video, that's a really good name. I like that name. Frozen Video, but I don't like that happening.
And no, boo. Yeah, it's really laggy today.
Yeah, well, we are filming in the lounge, and we don't have a direct plug-in when we film in the lounge. But,
So she was around for, 3 years after I had given it to you?
Yeah,
and
right.
I was on my trip in Toronto, and I was actually staying with my family, and it was one of those moments that I'll never forget. I was staying on my front porch, having a glass of wine, and all of a sudden I got a text. Princess has died. I am so sorry. And I kid you not, I shed a little tear of sadness because the memories and the times we've had with her.
I know.
So.
Princess was a lot of fun. And she actually did every single show with me, like all 60-plus shows at the time it was. Despite, you know, there was a couple that she couldn't make it to, obviously, if we were filming not in the studio. But, yeah, she put in some hard work at Pot TV. And Marius, I wanted to have Marius on here because I wanted Marius to actually take the first hit of the new bong as a just a good-faith gesture and as a way to christen the bong. The bong slayer should christen the new bong. But I want Marius to come on and just explain to the people what happened, actually, with Princess, because it was just a silly mistake.
So come on,
Mr. Marius, come on over here, brother. Yeah, you could come on this side, I guess. Why not? We haven't gone to our long shot, but I don't actually see that camera in my selection of cameras here. No. And we actually also have Kush.ca in the house. Mr. Mark Klokeid over here, Med Mark. And it's so choppy right now that I don't even know if they can see any of that, but as I turn the camera here, it'll look at the delay on that one. It's still way back in time. Is it like that on the other one, Marius? Oh, okay, you can see it on that end. Good. So, Marius,
I'm not in it yet, but here,
why don't you tell what happened with Princess?
Well, it was it last Friday? It's 2 Fridays ago.
More this week?
And we had done the show, and we were doing some live bong hits, kind of real time after the show. We were just, you can still see the last few hits of Princess there, and we were just setting down the table when I put Princess down on the ground. I thought she was pretty safe there, and I noticed that the glass table that we're using was really dirty, and I started scrubbing it. But behind me, unbeknownst to me, Princess was still there, and I didn't even feel anything. All of a sudden, smash. And Jeremiah was about 2 feet away, and he looked, and I looked, and it was just awful. I feel really terrible about it, and I'm really sorry to Jeremiah and to Mel and to everybody who loved Princess. And that's, you know, that's, that was and a lesson hard learned. I will never put a bong on the floor again. There was another glass incident. I just bought a new phone, and the next day I pulled it out of my pocket, and it just seemed to fly out of my hand, and I cracked it on a rock. So I don't know. I guess I was feeling guilty or whatever, and I broke that one too. But anyways, hopefully the dark streak is over, and like I said, I feel really devastated about everything. But I'm glad Jeremiah was able to get a new bong. And life goes on.
That's right. And you're going to take a hit out of it now. But then after that, you're never allowed to touch it again.
Yeah.
Oh, I have some really nice PK. What do you got there? Kush.ca grinder there. One of the new titanium Kush.ca grinders. And so I can't really, I'm having a hard time really seeing anything on this shot, like where we are exactly. Oh, that camera's going down. Oh, nice. Oh, yeah, Mark, you should grab that thing.
I'm going to grind up the weed for the bowl.
There you go. With a new Kush.ca titanium grinder.
Titanium grinder, yay.
Woo! And here she is. So this is just kind of like a lounging show. I'm going to play you guys some videos from the TY Expo. Just a few things. Actually, rather than even try and produce the show here, I'm going to try and load in the video I wanted to play for you guys. Yeah, but we're also going to talk about... I wanted to talk about some hilarious stuff that was in the news. Obama's Choom gang. Now, you probably saw us talk about this on the Wednesday show if you guys were tuned in. But this whole Choom gang thing is hilarious. I guess there's a book coming out very soon, another biography of Obama. And in it, they talk about the fact that when he was a young man, he was a member of what him and his friends called the Choom gang. Choom is like a Hawaiian word that means getting high. And so him and his buddies had this pot gang where they puffed down, and they had even rules. There was this 10-second total absorption rule that when you took a hoot in your lung, when you hit the joint or hit a pipe or whatever else, you'd have to hold it in for 10 seconds for total absorption.
You had to obonga it?
Obonga it, exactly. So how's that looking? Can they see the bong? I believe it's in front of the camera.
Greg?
Can they see the bong, Marijuana Man?
Okay.
Yeah, it really reached to get down there.
So the name Duchess came up twice. That's interesting, by two different people.
I'm really keen on that.
I like
it. It's unique.
What's that, Mark?
It's unique.
It is unique. Duchess. And then you can say, pass the Duchess on the left-hand side.
There you go.
So that might have to be...
And it was from the chick from
right
Norway.
Off the top. Why even... Yeah. Was it a girl from Norway?
It was a girl from
somebody
Norway.
Else... I believe it was either Cosmic Jest or... Now, I'm having trouble remembering who it was, but if they're in the chat, they should speak up as well. I remember I was chatting yesterday or the day before with somebody in the chat, and they mentioned the name Duchess as well. So we might have to give out a couple prizes. Sure, or you go first, Mel, and I'll go after you. So taking hits out of the new bong. But as you take a hit, Mel, I'm going to try and load up this video. So if you guys haven't seen, on the front page of Pot TV, the new Pot TV, which is totally redone, looks awesome, there's all kinds of videos from the Treating Yourself Expo that we were at last weekend. I was there, Mel was there, Med Mark was there.
Urban Grower.
Urban Grower, yeah, and I've got even a couple Urban Grower videos on Pot TV now. And they're great, actually. In fact, one of the ones I want to load in right now is an Urban Grower video. And it's such a great video. It's a glass-blowing one. It's showing off the new element of the TY Expo this year that was glass-blowing. They had the cool glass one.
My favorite. It was really stepped up the game for the show, I thought. I was really just mesmerized by it.
Yeah, you were in there recording stuff with your camera, too.
Tons. Yeah, I just couldn't stop filming. It was just awesome to watch.
Have you seen a lot of glass blowing before?
Not that much. I had been at Hot Carl's place and stuff and watched him do it there. But, I mean, the guy doing the tower, it was just huge, this big, huge globe he was working on. So, yeah, it was just really cool to see it all done and nine people at once doing it.
And it was cool that it was a competition and they had these teams doing it there. And they had to come up with something unique. I really liked the CN Tower one with the spider, robotic spider climbing it. That was awesome.
Yeah, it was really awesome. All the ideas were cool. Really intricately done, and I mean, they had a short amount of time to do it, so it was just all done quickly, and anyone could go view it, so it was really cool.
Yeah, it was. It was totally awesome.
We're having a sneeze competition. I think everyone should count how many times Jeremiah sneezes, and we're going to ask you at the end of the show.
And I have some competition already because Mel's sneezing too. So we brought back the TY virus, I think. The Treating Yourself Medical Marijuana Virus.
Or maybe it's that new bug. The kisser bug. The Chavez bug. What's it called?
The
kisser
bug?
Do you hear about that? The 5 million people are infected with it already.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's a whole nother show.
Oh, it's from passing these joints around to so many people. So, yeah, that was cool. There was some other, like, the world's biggest vapor lounge was pretty cool. Did you hit the Verdamper, Mark?
Yes. Yes, I did. Just to meet him again every year is just an event in itself.
Yeah, exactly. Now, and why is that? Why do you like meeting Everett?
He's just over-the-top obnoxious and just really into his product. And, yeah, it's like a showmanship of a salesperson, you know.
He's the guy who invented
like
the
squeegee guy, you know.
Yeah, Vince.
Yeah. Same idea, just his own character. So, but yeah.
No, he's very eccentric. And actually, Mick bought a Verdamper. And if you guys saw the Monday show, which was just the day after the TY Expo ended, Mick actually brought his Verdamper back to British Columbia. And I don't think he was able to set up for the show because he just got here. But he's been at home getting cords that he needs for it, one with a ground and a bunch of other stuff. And so I believe on Monday he'll have the first Pot TV Verdamper puffs in studio Verdamper.
That's exciting.
Although he found out that somebody else does have one in BC. There's a few people who have
one. Oh, he thought it was just him?
He didn't know if anybody else had one or not. He hoped that it was just him, I suppose.
Well, until he actually sees the other one in here, then it hasn't been, you know.
That's true.
Could have been broken.
That's true. Could might not have the right cord.
Maybe.
So, what did Mark you bring here? You brought some of this popcorn.
I brought the popcorn.
The popcorn is so good, man. I love this popcorn.
For sativa, I went with the sweet AK.
And oh, nice. Sweet AK.
This one's Master of Kush.
Master of Kush. Not Master Kush, but Master of Kush.
Yeah, this is the Master Kush from VIP. Those are the guys from MedPot now. And this is the Real and Chemo.
Nice.
And we got some chocolate butter.
Chocolate butter, oh my god.
That just looks amazing.
That's going to blow our minds.
All from iMedicate.
All from iMedicate. So tell us what's going on with iMedicate. Anyway, I know you have one location that's open right now, but after the raid happened, what went down?
Basically, when we spoke with the police, they basically said they had residential complaints, and that's why they came in, and that they came in with quote-unquote white gloves. That's what my lawyer told me, and he spoke with them, and that if we'd reopen, that they'd come back with black gloves. So,
What does that mean? Is that a threat?
Yeah, basically, they'd smash everything. It was a threat. Black gloves or white gloves? I don't know. Anyways, maybe they're Michael Jackson fans or something. Anyways, so I chose not to reopen. I did speak with the school, the principal of the school, and, you know, they said they hadn't complained, and that they'd received a couple residential complaints themselves. So, you know, I basically am going to be reopening dispensaries in other locations. I am working on another one in Coquitlam by Burnett and Blue Mountain. And so that'll be opening up shortly. And so look for the announcement for that in the next couple weeks. And I'm also looking at opening up one in downtown Vancouver in the near future. So Yeah.
Very cool.
Close one, open two. That's the motto.
One step back, two steps forward.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but now we had have we've talked to you on the show before about your health expo you were planning here in the city of Vancouver, which was with the help of the Pacific National Exhibit there.
Yeah.
It was going to be more focused on health. Wasn't going to have marijuana in the name, but you're actually taking this year off to try and get that together, right?
Yeah, well, we basically decided to push the dates longer. We had a lot of contract issues with the P&E, basically for policing and stuff like that, but we're going to move forward. We just, you know, trying to do it in 3 months was maybe a little bold on our part, and rather than, you know, try and pull off half a sold show, we'd rather do a big, huge expo that's, you know, fully prepared, so... And but we're doing it. We still have the dates that we're going to be picking, or it's going to be for the following year. So, but we're going to do the Kush Cup still, and that's not going to go away. It's going to go down regardless. And but we're doing the Health Expo for sure. And we were still allowed to be able to use marijuana print and pictures and stuff like that. The whole idea was to appeal to other people that would not normally come to a pot show. So, and I think it would bring a lot more other people from the public to come, so.
It's a cool idea, actually, piggyback it, and because when they come for the health stuff and you get that crowd who's already into, like, alternative methods of doing things.
Yeah, I mean, it's midsummer, and it's going to have a lot of people at the P&E. If you've ever been to the P&E, the fairgrounds there, it really does have a family environment. So the fact that the P&E is willing to, you know, partner up with us and allow us to throw a show there that's like this is actually cutting edge for themselves, right? They did have to go consult with the other directors of the P&E because it is owned by the city. So, but we've worked everything out, and I think it's best just to, you know, go forward with a really good thought out planned event.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's a smart way to do it, man, because you don't want to jump into it and not have it work in any way.
It's just not enough time, because we want to have a lot of the European companies there, and to get a lot of them, they need time to plan their travels to be able to come. So in the short amount of time, it would have been really local, which would have been fine, but it's a big venue, over 50,000 square feet. So, right. Yeah, it's going to go down. It's just we're just going to give it a little more time.
Cool, man. And... I guess basically we'll have to keep in touch with you about that till next year. But there's something else that's going on. Now, this is this marketplace to YouTube myself.
Well, it's been deloaded. We're back.
We're back. On which camera? This guy.
Okay.
Camera one?
Camera one.
So, you didn't get to see the comic, did you?
Okay.
Why weren't you paying attention?
So, it's because we had technical difficulties.
That's right. It wasn't your fault.
Okay, so here.
I guess.
I'll grab the camera. And we'll do like a handheld thing.
Yeah, just okay, so watch that bong.
Watching the bong, the Duchess does not need... Okay, so we start with that panel. Can you see that? Is that coming through? Hey, man.
We need a monitor.
Tell you what you think. And so then it goes to this panel. And then it goes down to this panel. Bing! Boing, 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 boing. Spring! So how was it? It's okay. Isn't that amazing? Did everyone see that now?
That's pretty funny.
Yes. And this, like so there many other things, can be yours for just $180 in the frame.
For just $99.99.
For, just...
And $99.99.
200 easy payments of 80 cents each.
200 easy payments. So that's very cool, David. And this is hanging anywhere at the time? Can people come and look at this?
Art gallery.
It is in the art gallery at the moment.
At the Herb Museum. So, with about 100 other beautiful works of art.
Can we see David?
Can you see me? Are you receiving me?
So I just... Can we see David?
I just wanted to plug the art gallery at the Herb Museum because, like, right now... it's paying for about 2/3 of its expenses. So we just need to make about $120 a day, and then we're breaking even. So please come and spend money at the Herb Museum. Buy some art. Check out the Herb Museum itself. It is very cool. We got a volcano vaporizer for those who like to vape, to medicate as they educate, and burn as they learn.
What's the donation to get in? Or what is
The first two rooms are free. So if you don't have any money at all, just come on down and check out the first two rooms for absolutely no money at all. But if you like what you see and you have $5, then you can see the other cool two rooms. The room of the psychoactive botanicals and the room of the the synthetics and non-psychoactive botanicals. And yeah, it's fun for the whole family. Come on.
There's just so much there to see that even going down there once or twice, you can't absorb it all. You have to come back and see it again and again.
That's right.
The ancient medicine bottles are my favorite, and the opium pipes, the new opium pipes.
The new opium pipes, thanks to Kush.ca for providing that.
From Cambodia, yeah, I brought them back. So awesome.
Pipes. Yes, and we have an aphrodisiac section. You can check out old pharmaceutical-grade aphrodisiac medicine bottles, and we have about 70 cannabis medicine bottles. We got opium medicine bottles, heroin, morphine, cocaine medicine bottles. We got all sorts of hallucinogens and absinthe and pipes, bongs, and rolling papers from the past.
So, David, switching gears here. Well, that's awesome about the Herb Museum. Actually, give me the website address before I check
gears. Yes, herbmuseum.ca if you want to check us out online. And hopefully the Pot TV tour of the Herb Museum, where you can get a taste of what's in store for you, will be re-uploaded.
Well, and actually, David, I had a question about movie night. Is that happening? Are we doing a movie night or what?
Well, all we're missing now is the curtains. And I heard that they're coming.
Curtains. Yes.
Curtains. So once we have curtains, we can make it dark in there. And once we make it dark in there, we can hang our projector. And
we
have the projector. Fantastic. We have the wall. All we're missing is curtains now, and then we can start movie night. And then it's curtains for boredom in Vancouver. You will always have a place to go. I think at least once a week, we'll have a couple of pop movies playing.
Why not have the? I mean, even there's so many movies to play.
Oh, yeah, we have like hundreds of movies in our collection.
We could play at least a couple nights a week, even.
Yeah, we could
do. It doesn't cost anything to throw a damn movie on.
No, we'll see how well attended it is, and if people are digging it, it'll be more than once a week.
Well, you can medicate and watch your movies.
That's right. Yeah. If you like smoking pot and watching movies, and I know some of you do, then the BCMP is the place to be. You can get high and watch movies with me.
DML,
I'm
JV.
I'm a poet, and I had no fucking idea.
That's right. Anyway. So the thing I was going to ask you about, David, was, and this is totally switching gears, but when I was at...
Monopolist, fuck them.
No. I know not to get you going on that here.
Don't get me going on
that's
that.
A whole show's worth.
Language.
Oh, right.
Language. We're
Fart
live.
Fart them all.
Beep!
Frig
beep,
them beep, all. Beep. Monopolist can
we
go
can the censorship
take a
on the
fly
side.
And fart at a rolling donut.
There was a doctor at TY named Daryl Hudson, and he was talking about the genome project for cannabis, the Cannabis Genome Project, where they've identified all of the genes of cannabis and made them available to everybody as a way to, as an activist technique, to try and stop the corporations
open,
from...
Open patenting.
Exactly, that kind of thing, right?
Yes.
So he was actually, I saw him speak, he was really great. The video of him speaking is online. I wanted you to watch it because I wanted your input about it. You and I have had discussions about genetic modifications of things before. What he talked about was, he said there's not actually any evidence that genetic modification in itself is bad. He said the bad part is when they take, like, a plant, and then they take an insect, and they put them together, and they get some weird thing that they have no idea what the hell's going to happen with it.
Right.
What he says is, when you take two plant genes, and you mix them out of the same plant, there's no evidence that that has any sort of...
Why can't we just stick to breeding them? What can genetic modification give us that breeding can't?
Well, in his talk, he talks about the new biotechnology and cannabis science, and he talks about a lot of the benefits of being able to manipulate those genes.
That's the chemo you're smoking.
Like Roundup Ready cannabis?
We're smoking chemo.
Is that
it's
the
delicious.
Benefits? We're going to get some Franken cannabis?
No. He made sure to talk about the pharmaceutical companies and how he was against what they were doing and the way they were able to patent all this stuff and change these things. But it was quite interesting. And I could play the video for our audience here at the end of the show. It's, I think, about 25 minutes, but it's really interesting stuff. I enjoyed it. You can find it right now at the front page of pod.tv.
Yeah.
That's where David's going to find it, I'm sure.
Well, I'll check it out, and I'll try to keep an open mind. But so far, all I've seen from the genetic modification crowd is stuff that allows you to use more pesticides than you ever could before, and stuff that, quite frankly, is pretty sketchy, like mixing animals and plants together. Nobody knows the effects of that, and why should we take any risk at all? What are the benefits? The benefits, I haven't seen the benefits. Has GM resulted in higher crop yield anywhere on Earth? It seems like it's been rejected in places like India, where GM rice and GM crops have resulted in like hundreds, if not thousands, of farmers killing themselves from going bankrupt. And instead of committing suicide, I'm good. Instead of committing suicide, they started fighting back and then banning GM from their country. It just, you know, it's another excuse to patent some. And we shouldn't be patenting things that have existed. We shouldn't patent the sun. We shouldn't patent life forms. And we shouldn't patent things that have existed previously. And all these cannabis medicines, they're like neem. Neem, at one time, the U.S. government tried to patent it, or U.S. pharmaceutical companies tried to patent neem, and they made a whole bunch of really lame arguments.
What is neem?
Neem oil is comes from tree that grows in India. That's a good antibiotic, and it's good for a whole bunch of medicinal uses. And
neem.
It's a natural medicine, and if you Google the neem patent, you'll find out that as soon as it was challenged, they said, okay, no, there's such a thing as prior art. If it existed in the past, you can't patent it now. And this medicine has been around for like 2,000 years in India. So, and cannabis has been around for just as that long. And they're looking for excuses to patent it. Why give them those excuses? Why even open patent it? That means...
Well, what he said is you can't... And the system's already there, so whether or not we like it, that's the one that's in place.
But the prior art system is also in there, and the prior art is a way to challenge...
But it's not the actual substance that's being patented, it's the process of making it, according to this doctor. He says that it doesn't really... You can't patent a plant.
By genetically altering, they can patent that process and patent the plant itself,
GM,
and that's the purpose of doing it.
The plant itself, so that...
But they make it resist...
You can sue anyone who might happen to get a hold of your seeds. Like, there's this guy named Percy Schmeiser, and he was growing canola seed, and some GM seed pollen floated onto his crop, and then Monsanto sued him for patent infringement.
Right.
I don't want to ever see that happen for pot or any other crop. I don't want to ever see that happen ever again. I haven't seen the benefits of GM anywhere pointed out to me. No one's been able to show me the big
greed is the only benefit I've seen.
And all I've seen is drawbacks. I'm good. I'm a one-hit wonder these days.
I keep
days.
Doing that. Can't help it. I just want you to smoke marijuana.
Man. You just love
I'm sure you don't want to hit out a Duchess. Oh, I haven't hit
I
Duchess
I don't even
yet.
Think you have hit her.
I have not hit her yet.
I patched her. That's all for you.
And we didn't say happy 420 at 420.
No,
either.
We didn't. We're a little delayed on everything today. We were kind of breaking her in before we even brought her down.
I had a lot of this popcorn. And the audience will know if they were watching the last time Ed Mark came on the show. Man, by the end of the show, I was just...
insane.
Couldn't even move. I was laid back in my chair, like...
How much butter is in that joint I just hit?
None. Just a beautiful, clean strain of chemo.
Super potent. No, again, I'm super high.
It's the UBC chemo.
You have to leave, so I stopped passing things to you.
I do have to leave, but thank you for having me on the show. I will check out your link to the GM stuff. But, you know, I've written about it. It's on our website, along with Dr. Lester Grinspoon. We wrote an article a couple years back called I think that's a good line of what you can patent and what you can't patent. You can patent inventions. Sure, you invented something, you built it in the back of your garage, and it never existed before you brought it into this world. If for the next 20 years, make a shit ton of money on it, I don't mind. But if you start patenting discoveries, then you start suing people who shouldn't be sued, and that's wrong. So that's my feelings on that.
All right.
That's why? That's why I get the big bucks from spreading my jewels.
That's why we call you a doctor.
My pearls of wisdom all over you.
Yeah, just aim it at my...
I'll just aim my pearls on your breasts there. Yes. Okay.
All right. Well, thank you, David. That was quite nice. You always bring quite a sort of bizarre of things, right?
I always class up your shows.
That's right. That's not quite what I was going to say, but it's like this Malmo circus. He's always got a little bit of everything.
I got props. I got jokes.
Hey, he's got jokes.
What does an extractor sound like?
Question: what does an extractor fan sound like?
I don't know. What does an extractor fan sound like?
I used to like tractors, but now I don't.
I used to like tractors, but now I don't.
Something or other.
Thanks, David. He's got a career as a stand-up comic.
He is. That DML, pretty funny.
All right, so we're still on camera one here, though I can't see it even though I'm in the studio. So this is the, what is this, chemo?
Yeah, that's the ABC chemo.
Oh, we're on camera two. How long have we been on camera two for? Oh, I've been like talking to camera one. I see.
So I think you should take your...
Yeah, it's about time, I guess, to hit Duchess here. No, not yet. All right, I will. I have hit her before. This isn't my first hit. I have had her
you
for
You were breaking
days
her
at
in at home.
That's right. So this isn't my
when
first
I came
time.
Home yesterday, I took a look and I was like,
and
yay.
I also am wearing the stuff
this
I bought in Toronto.
Live show.
I got a cool G.I. Joe / cannabis shirt modified to say ganja if you can't see it. Mel, would you take the microphone?
Dual mics.
Dual mics.
I can hold one, give you a play-by-play. First live hit by Jeremiah on the new beautiful Bong Duchess.
The Duchess.
She's pretty.
She is pretty.
Duchess, yeah. Girl from Norway. That's experience right there.
There goes my iPhone.
Like a champion, man. You took it like a champ.
Wider. Seems a little wider than Princess, which is nice. So it comes through faster. Just very slightly. What do you think?
Yeah, we agreed on that earlier. Yeah. She does rip pretty nice. But, you know.
Wow. That would hit me pretty hard.
Is it not pitched as hard? Yeah. Is that not pitched as much as the last one?
That might be why.
CNA.
I'm not sure. We have to compare the corpse.
Oh, the baby.
Expectorant.
No, of course. Yeah,
marijuana is a great expectorant.
I'm going to start packing up everything.
Yeah. And,
right.
Long...
So I went to my doctor's office because if you follow the show, you know that I recently broke out in some sort of weird tomato hives when I took one little pill of Advil for no reason. And then when I was at the TY Expo.
Tylenol, wasn't it?
Well, at the TY Expo afterwards.
Yeah.
I took one Tylenol and my hands broke out in these little teeny dots, not quite like the tomato-ish maniac thing that was going on when I had to go to the
Did you experience itchiness or
yes, totally itchy?
How'd your mind feel? Like
when
you...
the first time it happened, I felt like I had a fever.
Yeah.
But when I was at the TY Expo, I was feeling okay. It didn't seem much, but it still seemed odd that I broke out in hives on my hands 40 minutes after taking some sort of a pill that has something to do with taking, like, headache medication or whatever. Went to the doctor to find out if there was some sort of cold medication.
Did he get to look
contain.
At it?
No, he didn't get to see it. He kind of just said, he didn't believe me, really. He said that he didn't think
him?
That I could be allergic to both Advil and Tylenol. So that's a good thing. Maybe the hives the second time were from something else. Who knows?
Was it all in Toronto, or...?
No.
No.
No, it was in Vancouver the first time. But anyways, the point of the story is when I was at the doctor's office, I started talking to him about cannabis and about all the different studies, and he knew a little bit of, just a little tiny bit of information, but he really didn't know a heck of a lot. And so I started telling him about the Harvard University study that showed that cannabis does
I
not...
I love educating doctors.
I know, it's a lot of fun.
Enlightening them. Pointing them in the right direction.
He was really interested.
Correcting them.
Yeah, but he was skeptical, and we actually even talked about Bob Marley and the death of Bob Marley. And he said, well, if cannabis doesn't kill anybody, why'd Bob Marley die?
You were the reason I had to wait 2 hours to see the doctor.
Ah,
you're just having these
true.
Long chats with the doctor,
right.
Eh? Well,
yeah, we talked
in depth
for much longer about marijuana and Bob Marley than about my symptoms.
I do the same with my doctor. I think they're bored with the same old things, so they're just down to talk about interesting things.
He's like, you got a fatty with you or what?
Yeah.
Let's go hit the
samples
bathroom,
next time.
Toilet.
I want to recommend my patients different strains, so I would need a sample package if you could, please.
That's right. I talked to him about that, the influence of pharmaceutical companies, because actually, I mentioned to him that I had Dr. David Allen on my show, and that he talked about using cannabis, having a bud a day, to keep the doctor away by reducing the risk of stroke, I guess, because when you take pot like that, it reduces your high blood pressure. It stops high blood pressure totally.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was skeptical about it. He's like, well, who was he working for? What was he trying to profit from? And I was like, what do you mean? He was trying to tell people what he thinks works. He's like a doctor. He's trying to help people. He's like, no, what was his agenda? I was like, what? I'm looking into the mind of the Canadian healthcare system right now, into the mentality behind it. Is this what you're telling me, that they're just focused on agendas, who's behind paying for things? Is this your doctor's perspective? And he was like, he just kind of like shut up for a second, and he was like trying not to laugh.
Well, I was talking to my doctor about how much paperwork he's got to do and the amount of work and how much he makes, and he was saying that he'd rather have been a pharmacist, and then those guys can make up to like $40,000 to $60,000 a month being a pharmacist.
Really?
And only 2 years of education needed it for it. So he was, that was one of the conversations I had with him.
I want to be a pharmacist then.
You want to help people get pharmaceuticals?
Sure.
I don't know. Some of those are pretty deadly.
Drug dealer. Just a glorified drug dealer.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I guess if you're at the top.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's strictly controlled, though. So if you've ever had any past dealings with the police, then you won't be able to even go to school for that. So, not even a conviction. They really are controlled for the pharmacist course.
What kind of deal? What does that mean, dealings?
Say you got pulled over with an ounce, and they took it away from you.
What, that?
Yeah, if they wrote you up on that, then that could
go
on your history. Yeah, then you cannot be a pharmacist.
No, there's no way I'm being a pharmacist, then.
Yeah. Pharmaceutical industry, the most profitable industry in the world.
That's crazy. Yeah, and they're all owned by big corporations now, though. It's like PharmaSave, London Drugs, a couple here in British Columbia. It's not very many of them that own. Shoppers Drug Mart. They're all big corporations.
It's big business. I mean,
there's like one or two downtown Vancouver drugstores, independent ones left, like Owl Drugs or whatever they are, you know?
Yeah, well, and that's the funny thing you mention it, because a lot of them make a lot of money dispensing the methadone in the Vancouver area. So you see a lot of them in, say, Maine and Hastings up there. There's a lot of little small-time ones, and they have to come and get their methadone, and they get paid a dispensing fee for that.
Wow.
Regularly. So that's big business for them.
I was just reading on the front page of Cannabis Culture.
Shooters!
That they've now legalized. Here, let's just bring this up. I'm just going to bring up Cannabis Culture. Oh, Mel, you got to go?
I'm going to go. Bye, everyone. It was good chilling with you guys.
What one are we on now, Marius?
What one are we on? Bye. Bye, everyone.
Bye, Melly.
Bye. See you later.
So you like the new name?
Duchess.
It's pretty good. Thank you out there. It was Connecticut that became the 17th medical marijuana state. Now, did you hear about that?
No.
So, yeah, Connecticut.
On a state level.
State level. So
when's
it's
Obonga gonna
Obonga
bring back his chain gang days and make a 10-second rule that you have to inhale every toke?
Oh yeah, I didn't hold in my bong toke for 10 seconds.
You didn't. Obonga would be choked.
That's right. I'm not.
I heard there's a study that you can only absorb 3 seconds or something like that.
Well, I held it in yesterday out of the big bong for 10 seconds, and when I exhaled, there was almost nothing left. Total absorption.
So do you think
that one does? Yeah, it's got all these little bong water areas where things are happening, cleaning your chronicity. Yeah, she probably gives a cleaner one, but it probably deprives us of some chemical that gets you high. So
I think it. The very least.
Oh, Mel, before you go, I was going to ask you about glass, because I was going to play the glass blowing video. I have it queued up right now, actually. Or Marius, can you queue it up? But I wanted to ask you, Mel, about that. Do you have any time to talk about that before you go, or are you leaving right away? Just like super quick. Doesn't have to be much. We can even. Yeah, I don't know. Can the camera see you? Yeah, you can come around.
Hard at work.
Because, Mel, you were covering Glass for us when we were at the TY Expo.
Yay, Mel's back. Yay. Wow, he's reeled her back in. You're never leaving.
The talk of glass blowing, it's like, oh, that's how you always get me back in.
It was very cool to see so many glassblowers there participating in this cool project, this competition. But they weren't all Canadian glassblowers. These were some glassblowers from the States as well.
Yeah, no, these were all United States glassblowers that came up from the United States for the first Canadian flame off. But it was all
Toronto ones? I thought the Toronto ones were from Canada.
No, Team Toronto was from the U.S. Yeah.
The other ones from the States.
Yeah, everyone was from the United States who came up. We had Marcel come up, Paco, Chris Carlson, Chad G, J.O.P. We had Kurt B.
Jean-Luc Picard?
No, I said J.O.P.
Oh, J.L.P.
Yeah. then we had Big Z. We had Ben Burton, and then we also had Brandon Martin.
Nice.
Yeah.
Cool. So I'm going to play Remo's video. It's Urban Grower up there, up close and personal. But Mel, you tried to get in there, but we couldn't get in because you were banned from hanging out behind the scenes. Because only, as Marco said, only the wives of...
It was kind of weird because I'm friends with all the glass artists, and before I even had gone in to take photos, I had asked all of them, I asked Chris, do you mind if I come back and take photos? And he's like, no, for sure. And I even asked Kirby, I was like, do you mind if I take some photos? He's like, no, of course. And I asked everyone at each table if they mind if I was there to take photos. I told them I was covering it for Pod TV and live stream and that we'd be filming it live and everything. And they're really stoked.
Okay.
And they were really excited. But then they were actually really shocked that they wouldn't let me in. But it was fire hazard safety rules. But then there was also other people who were back there. So it was kind of, you know, there was the fire safety hazard rules, but then there was also other people back there who...
And you had a media pass.
Yeah, and I had a media pass, and other people were back there who didn't have a media pass, but, you know, whatever happened. I got back the second day, and I took Pot TV back there with live stream. Matt, Oliver, awesome. And I went through, explained it all, had a brief little talk with Marcel for a little bit. It was really fun.
It was fun.
For the record, thank you, Marco, for letting me do whatever I want.
And Marco did a really great job. TY was totally great this year, wasn't it? I mean,
it was amazing.
Oh, for sure.
I
mean, mainly it was safety, right? Like, I knew one of my buddies was there, got me.
We're not
there.
Trying to criticize.
I had the special glasses.
Well, I had the glass blowing glasses too. Yeah. And it's not my first time being around a torch or a kiln or a glass blower. I've spent a lot of times.
I wasn't saying you're unqualified. You know. I was just saying they're being really, really safety concerned.
I know, and I understand that. But we got back and we took awesome photos and awesome videos, and it was good.
It was great. And so you were impressed with the crowd they brought up? You thought Marco did a good job of getting the right people there?
Oh, yeah. I thought it was a lot busier both days. I don't know what anyone else thought, but I thought it was crazy. And I thought...
In the end, they said, I guess it was about the same. But Marco thought it was. It seemed like it was busier.
I don't know, but the whole at the glass blowing demo.
I thought the first day, the Friday actually had quite a few people compared to last year. I thought.
Yeah,
me too.
I thought the Saturday maybe was a little busier last year. It was still busy, right? But the Sunday was just as busy. This year's Sunday was really busy, so it evens out.
But at the glass blowing demo, it was like super packed outside on the patio where everyone was smoking. Super packed. I don't know. It was really busy. I really enjoyed it. Can't
really
wait for next
networking.
Year.
If you go to the expos, you know, all the stuff's really cool to see, but about the people that go to it is what's cool.
Yeah, it is. That's why. It's like a big family there. You get to see all the pot community friends that you have, and everybody in Toronto, pretty awesome. I love hanging out with all
the
people.
They do everything a little bit bigger in Toronto.
That's right. They do.
Yeah, they do.
A lot bigger, man.
Whew. Yeah.
Toronto's huge.
Yeah. Really exciting out there.
It is exciting out there. We always have a lot of
and,
fun.
And they really treat us Vancouverites really well. That's like all the lounges and the businesses out there. Even the cab drivers are really good.
Yeah, they are.
So I really have a great time. And I went to the best restaurant ever, Aria.
Why is it so
amazing.
Good?
It's got a small menu, and it's Italian, and it wasn't too expensive. But it's right by the Maple Leaf Center. some famous chef or whatever. You can Google it, and it's like at the top of all the reviews. And I went there, and it was just delicious.
Nice.
One more reason to go to Toronto.
All right, well, we should play this glass blowing video, and then we'll come back and hang out some more. It's already an hour and 6 minutes after four, but yeah, we're cool. I'm hanging out for a while, so I don't really plan on stopping anytime soon. I got some videos to play and stuff, so let's keep rolling, and we'll see you guys on the other side. Marius, can you cue that video up?
I'm going to be taking off. It's already off, ready to roll. I just want to thank you guys.
All right, you're going to take it off. All right,
Paul. I've got to get my daughter. It's the weekend.
Oh, it's Friday. Yeah, right. Yeah, it's Friday.
Yeah. Yeah, so I'll be off, but thanks for having me, and look for more content.
Yes.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
It's okay. It's rainforest that we live in, so.
Yeah.
I deal with the rain.
Exactly. It's always raining. Thanks for everything, man. Thanks for all the popcorn.
No worries.
I love this popcorn. It's like so good.
Yeah, you can get it on Medicaid. It's really good.
It is good.
$5.
$5 for a big sack
for
like
the big
that?
Bag. Yeah, the big
wow.
bag.
And that shit gets me so high. I swear to God.
Like mashed.
Then I just get totally. I'm going to go home tonight and sleep. Like.
I know. I'm going to sleep pretty good tonight, too.
Remember, that always happens whenever you come by.
So check out Kush.ca for info about the Kush Cup, too. Really excited. We're putting it all together.
Which camera we have, Marius? One or two?
Two.
Two still. Okay. Two. Looks like one on this thing. That must be camera one. All right. How long was that confused for?
You should tell us you switch cameras.
Yeah. Hilarious guy. Marius is the mystery producer.
I'll leave you guys with the rest of the popcorn.
Oh, man, we're going to get
delicious, high. Thank you.
I'll leave that for you guys, too.
Do you want to hit this thing?
No.
Oh, you probably should.
I'm about to drive.
Oh, he's got to drive. All right. What are you driving these days?
Corolla.
Oh, ooh. Nice. What year?
I don't even know. I think 82? It's like 2003 or something like that. I don't know. I'm balling heavy.
Heavy balling.
By the way, I love my Corolla.
Where's that going?
Love your Corolla.
Shouts out for the Corolla.
I dream of a van, though, so I could stretch my legs out. A Dodge Caravan. I used to have one, but I got rear-ended.
I've always wanted a Chevy van, like a 10-footer, you know, like the A-Team van, but an actual Chevy one with a little Chevy thing on the front.
Yeah.
Those are dope. 10-foot. Short box van.
Cars suck unless they don't use gas. I want to put that in there. I drive a Corolla for a reason.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah,
they and if you have a big car,
especially $1.50 a liter or whatever it is.
God, I can't believe how expensive gas is now. It's crazy.
You're double miking it.
Yeah, it's nuts. Okay, I got two mics.
Are they queuing up the video or what?
Yeah, Marius, can you play that video? Throw to video.
Okay, thanks for having me. Look out for more content. Urban Grower and
the Weed Guy.
The Weed Guy.
We're at the TY Expo and we're going to check out some glass blowing. Thank you. Mark. That's crazy looking shit. Nice glasses, man.
Thanks, thanks, buddy.
Where'd you get those?
Borrowed them. Student of CN Tower, dude. CN fucking Tower. For Canada.
Yeah.
Canada.
CN Tower.
You see a shirt? Oh, yeah. We bought the shirts. We love Toronto.
Nice. What are you making, man?
Nothing. Go behind us.
Pretty cool shit, eh, Sarah?
Pretty cool. This is wicked. You get the shot looking all the way down.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. This is an impressive display, I have to say.
Absolutely.
There's some really cool pieces of art here today.
I wonder if you're bringing a little smoke through the CN Tower when you're done.
Let's do it. I want to try.
Me too.
West Coast.
Yeah.
I went to Vancouver all the time.
I bet you did. Oh, look at this thing over here. Here's one coming together.
Cool. CN Tower.
Yeah, we're gonna win this last night.
That's awesome, man.
We're back. Is that correct, Marius? Nice. So that was the glass blowing. That was Urban Grower's video of the glass blowing. He was up close and personal with those guys. It's pretty cool. It was a nice touch, and it was a change to this year's expo. It was a new element, and I thought it was done very nicely. It was more interesting than some of the other things that have happened, like some of the speeches and stuff. I'm not really sure what was going on last year. Oh, it was music. That's what they had last year. They had bands and stuff. They didn't really have any of that this year, and actually, I'm glad they didn't. But I'm here with Jodie. Jodie, microphone.
And mic check.
Screw up Marius' whole shot here.
All right.
Yeah, how's that? Say.
Holy moly.
How's that, Mr. Marius? Is it great? Nice.
I like
Jodie.
This set. You should do your show from here all the time.
I know. It's cool, isn't it? It's a very nice background.
More casual.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, right. You normally have your shirt and tie.
I was just not feeling so great.
Yeah, no, that's understandable. It's been very busy. This guy works really hard, so.
I feel like a little clogged.
But sickness is going around. It's the spring sickness that happens every year.
But I'm trying to do it. It's like nice out. It's still beautiful outside.
It's gorgeous.
Even though, yeah.
I love the trees. That's what I mean. This is a nice spot to do the show from.
It is. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe the audience will let us know what they feel.
What do you think, guys?
Yeah. And they gave us the name Duchess. That's a great name.
Duchess is a great name. Yeah.
So, Jodie, what do you think? The TY Expo, did you have a good time?
I had a fantastic time. I was actually, last night I spent time, I watched your full show, the full hour, which was excellent, featuring John Conroy, Mick Mann, Matt Murnau, and me. I think
Marco Renda,
that's right, of course.
Yeah.
And it was a great segment. And I also watched my speech videos. There's two of them to brush up on what I should and shouldn't do for Idea City, which I'm nervous about. A big speaking engagement coming up. But anyway, Treating Yourself was fantastic. There's so many familiar faces and a lot of nice new faces. And we had a great time. I'm still upset at Canada Post for not getting our stuff there, costing us thousands of dollars in revenue meant to cover the cost of going out there. But Marco Renda was very generous to give us a gigantic Pot TV booth, which we utilized as much as possible out there with a lot of help thanks to the Vapor Central crew. I wonder if they're watching right now. Maybe they are.
They might be.
If you guys are watching,
thank you so much.
You guys are amazing. Matt Oliver, Matt Murnau, Chris Gooden, of course, as always. But yeah, you held it down out at the TY Expo. It was a lot of fun.
It was. I had a great time. I always love traveling, but the TY Expo, it's like, it's different than the GMM.
It's three long days of hard work. Really hard work. It's exhausting.
Look at this
It's
character.
Really exhausting. Hello, we've got Redbeard in the house.
And we're filming live right now.
Yeah, we're live on Cannabis Culture News. Live.
You want to come over and take
I could let you take the mic
well,
over
because
I'm.
Three of us can go.
Yep, that's. Oh, that's good. But I can fit him in here and.
And we can move the camera
take
back.
Take the middle.
Marius, is that camera two working?
Oh, maybe we can.
What's that?
There you go.
Is camera two working?
Camera one, camera two.
Camera one, camera two. Aha, now we're on camera two.
Are we?
Awesome. I made it in time.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah.
And actually, I saw, was there some talk on Facebook or somewhere of you actually coming down here today?
Yeah, exactly. I come all the way from the Okanagan, so it was a long ride. Yeah.
Oh, you did come all the way down?
Yeah, this morning.
Oh, use the mic, man.
This morning, came down from the Okanagan.
Oh, long drive,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
And so. Wow.
Yeah.
And so, how long is the drive, actually?
It's about 5 hours, yeah.
I take my time,
yeah. Yeah, stop often.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where do you stop?
Oh, all the little rest areas. There's a few campgrounds. My kids and I got a GPS unit, so we do that geocaching sometimes.
Yeah.
That's a lot of fun. Yeah.
What's
Gets
that?
Us off the road. It's just like hide and seek with a GPS unit.
Really?
It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People like hide things.
I was thinking we should start a cannabis version where we got stashed just like a bud or a pipe or some kind of fun stickers or something. You should start her own pot TV geocache.
That'd be hilarious.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow. So you have a lot going on, my friend.
Whoa, I do.
You have a lot going
busy.
On in this bag,
yeah,
actually.
I have some sour diesel that I brought that we should try out. It is magnificent.
Oh, wow.
It's so stinky.
It's...
I just saw him in his office.
Wow,
he pointed me
stuff.
In your direction.
This is glowing bright green.
Yeah, it's a greenhouse seed company.
It's really nice.
Wonderful strain. Yeah.
People could see that. I wish we could hold
it's
up
It's so fragrant. It actually, like my friends say, it's almost disgusting. You put your face in that.
Thanks, Jody.
It's almost disgusting. It's so fuely. It's pungent. Yeah.
Even though I'm clogged, I can still smell it.
2 6-foot charcoal filters in the room, and still a sealed room, and
so
still.
Are you a medical grower?
Yeah, yeah. I'm licensed by Health Canada. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. All
yeah.
Right.
Man, I can't eat without it.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's part.
Yeah.
Makes sense. And so I know you have the glass gathering coming up.
It's true. Yeah. That's our annual party, and we're really excited. Yeah, we're going to have some live streaming for that, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
nice.
It's indeed. Yeah, it's
been
talked
about. Is
there like
a Redbeard live stream?
Well, we'll see. We're going to maybe talk to you guys and get your umbrella over there. But I'm not involved with that technical part of it. There's talk of a few cameras in the there's talk of a few cameras in the tent. So what it is, every year we have 30 to 40 glass blowers blowing glass at the same time in a 60-foot-long outdoor tent. And it's on a farm up in the middle of nowhere, where the rules are lax and the people are friendly.
That sounds awesome.
It's a good party, yeah.
Wow.
And so it's gained a lot of momentum. This year's going to be epic. CCHQ is a major sponsor.
We're happy to be one.
Yeah.
I want to come this year myself. I want to go. Like, I love camping. I'm a fucking big camper. I camp every
there
single
we go.
Year, have my whole life.
What can I do to help you get up there?
A scout. Beaver cup and a scout.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I'm going to have to just see if I can afford to do it. I'm going to Shambhala this year, so that's going to be hitting my pocketbook in multiple ways.
Yeah.
And so I'm just trying to make sure I can afford to do everything I want to do. But it's all depends on a couple different things, factors.
Okay. Well,
and if I can take the time
we'll
to
get
do
a funky
these.
Bus pull up to the curb in front of your shop there, and we'll pick you up.
That'd be awesome. That'd be dope.
Yeah.
I would love to be in the funky bus, for
yeah,
sure.
We'll get you up there.
That's a nice touch.
Yeah. Are you on the bus, or are you off the bus?
Yeah. I'm on the fucking bus.
Yeah, man.
So, yeah, we were just playing a glass-blowing video, actually, from the TY Expo, where they had the competition
yeah.
there.
Wicked. I missed it. I was so choked. I was trimming that sour diesel, but I missed it. What an epic lineup of artists. If I could have been there, I would have been there. Yeah.
It was pretty amazing. It
I'm
was pretty amazing.
So you got some video for me to watch online?
Yeah, well, actually, on the front page of pot.tv right now, you can watch a ton of different videos from the TY Expo, including from the Urban Grower. He took some great video.
Yeah.
And so we're now syndicating the Urban Grower's content.
Awesome.
And actually, the Urban Grower and the Weed Guy are going to be making some original content for Pot TV as well, and doing some live stuff. And
awesome. Those guys are coming up to the gathering. And in fact, I'm working with them on their Health Expo. I'll be making the prize cups for the different trophies for the different categories.
Very nice.
Yeah, so that's pretty busy for me on the next month.
I bet.
Yeah.
So is there like a website or two that people can go to find out
right
more?
Right now we're just on Facebook and the word of mouth. You can contact me at redbeardglass.ca. Their Facebook page is just called the 5th Annual Great Canadian Glass Gathering.
Right.
We had a website and we lost that domain. I think someone's selling soap there or something now.
Oh, what? No shit.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Gotta
soap.
Renew those things.
Yeah, exactly.
So there are a number of ways of finding us, though. We got a flyer coming out, and it's not a huge party. It's a long ways to go, so only the dedicated travel that far. It's an easy 4 hours from Vancouver up into the woods.
Four hours isn't that bad.
It's not so rustic. There's running water and hydro and everything like that. And we built some fancy outhouses for this event. But you got to be willing to camp and rough it. So it was not a huge party. It's going to be a tight.
It's work,
scene.
But it's a party.
Yeah.
Hey, man, you got to work in order to play. So
that's it.
It makes it that much sweeter when you get there. You're like, you lay back, eat your hot dog, and have a good time.
Yeah,
sip your beer or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll have an organic kitchen. I'm really excited about my friend Steve's going to be cooking.
So you can smoke up there, out anywhere kind of thing?
Oh, yeah. Well, our biggest concern there is forest fire. So we'll be always conscious on that level.
Ashtrays.
Yeah, safety first on that regard.
And what about drinking alcoholic beverages?
Once you're on site and you're drinking, then you just can't drive. That's our only rule.
Oh, I see. Okay, well, that's
and hopefully
that
we'll
seems
find
very
you
fair.
A comfortable place to lie down when you're done.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
it's not too much ethanol. It's not an ethanol-derived event. It is a more of a cannabis-friendly event.
Right,
it's
exactly.
Mostly pipers that show up. I'd say 9 out of 10 are pipers.
Yep.
If there's a single bead maker in the group, that'll be great to see. Yeah.
Really? Cool. Mm. Awesome, man. I would love to go. We got to try and get Jodie to come.
Yeah.
That's get her to mission
out. She's gone to visit Mark this time.
I know.
So. Yeah. Good. Good. And the year Mark gets out, we'll have a really big celebration of that.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Cool, man. That's awesome. And so, what else you got in your sack here?
Well,
you show them what you had there? Like.
Well, that's
quite the bag.
Yeah, that's under my limit. I'm allowed to carry. This isn't quite my 210 gram limit.
Right.
And that's actually the only strain I brought in.
I see.
This titanium grinder is full of ground up sour diesel. We should probably
one. Nice. We probably should. Or you could take a hit out of the.
Is that your replacement?
This is the replacement,
baby?
And this is the last high guy I could find like this because they stopped making it.
Exactly.
Yeah, the 3-footer. They don't make them anymore.
Well, I'll see what I can
and
do.
And so
about
maybe
that.
You know, is high guy now moved all the way to China? Is there a plan?
Oh no, high guy's in I believe the Lower Mainland. He's in the Langley area.
Okay.
Yeah, he works almost exclusively with the Puff catalog. That's pretty much what I know about him. He's been around for a long time.
Yeah.
A long time.
Why do I keep hearing that they moved to China?
I wouldn't believe that.
No,
I wouldn't believe that.
Good. Okay, I'm glad to hear that from you.
Someone with a very similar name very well could be making glass from China. There's a lot of Chinese glass out there.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And a lot of clones. Actually, this is interesting because when we were at the TY Expo, spoke with Martin, I can't pronounce his last name, from
Brizel.
Yes.
Yeah, Brizel or
Brizel,
something.
Yeah. From Ruhr, yeah, and he was telling us all about the counterfeit glass trade and how it's taking a big toll on the regular glass trade and how there's just all these clones everywhere and they look like Ruhrs and they, like, you know, but they're kind of shabby and everything, right?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
They make direct clones, and then he was getting choked, and he was actually getting choked at Pure Glass, who was, like, right across the way because they, like,
they were at
same,
the expo.
They were right there across from the Ruhr booth.
I saw some controversy online with the Pure name,
And so
Chinese,
why is Pure, what's wrong with Pure exactly?
Well, I don't know the details exactly, and I don't want to be the one to say what they're not doing,
okay.
But from the controversy I read, they are made in China. That's all I heard,
really?
And maybe they're not marketing themselves as made in China. See, there's also a company near Vancouver that stocks most of the stores, and they put a red maple leaf on their label, and every single one of the products, as far as I know, is made in China.
Right.
You know? So... You know, it's you got to know where to get it from, and it's always best to get it from the blower themselves if you can find them. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Cool, man. Awesome. Well, actually, Marius, we have another video here. Oh, I was gonna play. Yeah, this is what time is it right now? 5:30. Well, we probably should get going after this video anyway. So this is the video I was talking about earlier. This is the cannabis biotechnology. What's the name of the actual video? Advances in Cannabis Biotechnology. That's what it is. By Dr. Daryl Hudson is his name, if I remember correctly. Oh, it's still loading? Okay, well, we still have some time. Marius has a video to play in honor of Princess. Right, I remember this, yes. Yeah, of course you can play it. You want to play that right now? I need a drink here. Yeah, you should play it, Marius. Thanks for coming on the show, by the way, man. That's awesome. You got to come on more often. We should have you come on and show some stuff off.
Yeah, I've thought of that as well. Maybe I'll work at this technology and get one of your cameras in my workshop for an afternoon.
Yeah, we can just go straight to you. We can.
Yeah.
If you have an internet connection that's fairly decent, we can just go right to you.
Yeah, I do. Yeah, we should do that.
Oh, that'd be great.
We'll look into
that.
That'd
be so much fun.
I'll have my techies get in touch with your techies.
Exactly. Yeah. I'll give you my card.
Thanks very much.
Awesome, man. Thanks a lot.
I love your show. Always on. You can see me on the chat.
Nice. What's your name in the chat?
Redbeard.
Yeah, just so, yeah, right. I knew it was. Yeah, Redbeard, of course. So, yeah, Redbeard's in the chat a lot of times, guys. So, there you go. That was a chatter on the show.
So Marius. Wanted to say that the next video is, it's in honor of Princess and all broken glass.
Before we go, I'm going to hit Duchess again here. And we'll use some of this stuff. I guess this is... Did this just come out of Redbeard's bag, I guess? I guess so. We're going to smoke it then. All right. And I forgot to promote the show on Facebook today. Yeah. I should have been doing that, but whatever. The show lives on in the on-demand library forever and ever. As long as it's recording, which it isn't. Look at the screen. Do you like that background? It's green and stuff. It's like all pretty out there. Jody says we should film the show in here all the time and do it always casual.
We'll have to fix the internet connection.
Yeah, the internet connection.
We'll have to fix the internet connection for sure.
Yeah, that'll be fixed. It won't be this choppy.
So, but yeah, that'll be awesome.
I was willing to sacrifice some of the quality. Just to be comfortable today.
Yeah, there's a lounge.
Which I'm not even really, because I'm still all clogged up.
Because you're all sick.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I should have been quarantined. I should be doing it from home by myself in front of my computer, probably.
Well, you know, you have that big plastic ball. What did we get it for you for?
The plastic ball?
You never use it.
I use it all the time.
Where's that lighter? I don't know. Did I snag it again? No, I don't think so. Not yet.
I'm gonna switch cameras.
Okay. Well, no, that's okay. I'll tip it. Okay.
I need a lighter though.
I don't know what happened to that one.
Anybody got a lighter? Anybody got a lighter? Marijuana man, you got a lighter?
Sour diesel.
Oh, the sour diesel.
Nice hit. Was that 10 seconds?
That was 10.
There we have our first official member of the Choom gang, BCMP chapter.
Wow, this thing, the Duchess hits very nice. She's smooth. I think what's happening here is that there's a larger air chamber in Duchess than there was in Princess. I think that Princess was probably pinched off a little tighter here. Even the neck itself was a little bit thinner.
We can compare it to...
We have the Princess's corpse downstairs.
They've never been together, have they?
No, they haven't. Maybe they shouldn't. Well. Maybe a bad juju, give it a bad vibe.
You said you were going to create zombie Princess.
There's such a wide pinch here that this thing hits like, bam, it's really nice. I like it. I'm
going to be extra careful whenever I'm near her.
Good find. I'm glad I found her in the Bong shelter.
I'm really glad you did too.
Yeah.
So this is.
Alright, so you're gonna play your
video. This is the video for all
Princess.
All sad, sadly, for all broken glass everywhere.
And we had just been talking about another Bong breaking. We're back. We're back. Back we are. All right, so that was funny, Marius. Heart of glass, Blondie. Yeah, well, no hard feelings, Marius. No hard feelings.
They do all have hearts of glass, though. You got to remember that.
Well, they have everything in glass.
Well, thank you, and thank you.
And thanks for caring so much about the glass.
Well.
And your own glass.
What
you
can
have.
I say?
I hope you get your screen brings, fixed as well.
Yeah, that should be soon. So yeah. Thanks.
Because your smartphone is just like another friend, like a bong. It's an important friend. I have mine. Where is she? Oh no. Or he.
Yeah. I never had one before. I've only had one for 2 weeks, and it was a shame to smash it as well. But
they're good.
I guess I was clumsy that weekend. What can I say?
Yeah, I guess so. Oh shit, that's an understatement. So I guess, is that video cruising or what?
Yeah, it's ready to go.
It's ready to go. So I wanted to play this video, and I guess this is how we'll leave it because it's already 5:42. I did want to play the normal Women's Alliance video, but I'm just going to direct you to the front page of pod.tv to watch that video. It's there right now on the front page. You can watch it. And if you watch this video at some point later on in time, if you just click the little more button at the bottom on the front of page, on the front page of pod.tv, more goes to a whole archive of all those stories. You can always go back and look at any old stories on Pot TV like that. So there you go. Tips for navigating pot.tv and cannabis culture. But yeah, anyway, this video is Dr. Daryl Hudson. And me and David Malmo Levine were sort of having a conversation about this earlier, the genetic modification of cannabis, that kind of stuff. This guy has some thoughts, some things to say about it, and I kind of wanted David to talk about what he thought, just sort of as a counterbalance to this, because I'm not really sure where I fall or who I agree with or what, but I think it's all very interesting on both sides. Anyways, this guy, I was kind of intrigued when I saw it the first time around. The quality of the video isn't the greatest in the universe, but you can hear it all and you can see, and it looks pretty good, or you can actually figure out what's going on. So take a peek and tell me what you think. And I guess that's it for today's show. Thanks for watching, and we will see you guys very, very soon next Friday, 4 p.m. Pacific time again, me and Marius and the regular cast of characters. And we'll probably be back in this spot because everybody seems to like this set a lot, including me. So what do you think, Marius? Make this our new set here in the corner of the lounge? Always film.
Well, I think it's beautiful. Lounge. Yeah, I love it here.
Should we give the, we should here, definitely, let's give the audience out there a little look at the lounge here. I'm going to spin it around. Yep, still live. I'm just showing off the lounge, and then you can look out the window here. Marius, your leg, maybe.
Oh, sorry.
Check out outside, out the window. And that's the Victory Square Park down there.
Beautiful Victory Square.
Very cool. So I don't know how great, if you guys can see or what, but anyways. Yeah, so we'll see you guys next week. And till then, check out Dr. Daryl Hudson at the TY Expo last weekend.
Hello. Did my topic scare most people off?
Yeah,
kind of thought so. I know it's Sunday and not that late, so I'll try and not put you all to sleep. I know it's a bit of a daunting topic, but we'll try and get through at least some of this. My name is Daryl Hudson. I've done my PhD at the University of Guelph in molecular biology and genetics. I've been there the past 7 years or so, and having recently left, I've started this consulting company so that I can continue work on this genome project. Essentially, we're trying to sequence all the cannabis genomes that we can get our hands on, so that's kind of what I'm going to talk about today. To just give you a brief overview of what I'm going to talk about, we're going to go through a bit of the history of agriculture here. So mankind has obviously been selectively breeding crops for about 10,000 years, and cannabis is essentially one of the oldest crops that we've been working on. So it's quite interesting from that aspect. Agriculture, maybe you can see kind of the background here is a view from space that's actually showing all these agricultural farms. And it's caused the single largest transformation of the Earth's ecosystem. but it's essential to support the economy that we have. We like to think we're maybe an oil-based economy or something like that, but without the freedom from having to worry about where your next meal's coming from, we don't have any of this, really. So when you see these signs or bumper stickers that say farmers feed cities, it really is the truth. Without overproduction and agriculture that we have, we wouldn't be able to have all this extra stuff and be able to focus on the things that we do in our regular lives. On top of that, there's substantial agricultural increases that are projected to be required in order to feed the population. It is growing, and as a result, a lot of the stocks have started to deplete. So it's a major concern for both farmers and the economies of the world. Another concern is that today over 80% of mankind's diet is provided by the seeds from a few species, and typically these are grown in monoculture, which has resulted in a lot of increases in yields, but also has provided the susceptibility to disease and things like that. So keeping diversity is something that we need to focus on, as well as creating the best monoculture crops. What's interesting is cannabis, being one of the oldest cultivated crops by man, is not one of these 12 species that we currently utilize in our common diets. And it still has amazing nutritional qualities and it's a multi-purpose crop that we should probably be incorporating into this regime. Again, it's multiple uses: food, oil, fiber, and medicine. And it originated in the Ukraine-Kazakhstan region, but was essentially spread by mankind across the globe for agricultural purposes. Just to give you an idea of what mankind has actually been able to accomplish with plant breeding, here's corn. You can see the ancestor of corn is this Teosinte variety, which essentially produces very small seeds that are of very little nutritional value, or at least not a lot of them anyways. With modern corn, they decreased all the branching and increased the kernel size and ear size significantly so that it's a viable agricultural crop. Rice has essentially had the same thing happen to it, where the conventional ancient rices were tall and had very small seeds. They produced some mutant varieties that were much shorter and able to use higher levels of nitrogen, and now the modern varieties essentially have very few strong tillers that produce a lot of seed. Cannabis is kind of the same. Breeders have been very successful, especially in the hemp world, at creating diversity. You can see kind of on the left there a really tall fiber strain, and on the right a very short seed oil strain being grown next to each other. And this essentially comes from the three different varieties of cannabis that we have: the sativa, indica, and ruderalis. So just touching briefly on cannabis as a medicine, this won't be news to most people here, but I just want to cover it because it gets into what the details of kind of what I'm going to talk about. Is that patients want a consistent, reliable medicine. This is what Dr. Bourdieu was talking about with standardization. Right? Standardization is key, especially for Health Canada to be able to accept this as a legitimate medicine. It has to be consistent and reliable. On top of that, patients want variety and selection. We know that one size does not fit all. One strain does not treat everything. So we're going to have to develop specific strains for specific illnesses. In order to meet the supply in Canada, obviously we need quality growers and suppliers of this medicine. And again, I think we need specific genetics. So, breeders, cloners, all this stuff has to become standardized in this country for it to be acceptable as a medicine. To me, it's kind of like if you went to the pharmacy and walked in and said, I have some illness, and they just gave you a handful of pills and said, one of these might work, right? It's kind of like that when Health Canada just provides you a bag of ground up whole bunch of plants, right? I mean, they don't know exactly what's in there, and they don't know exactly how it's going to work. And you can just see the difference between a nicely grown organic strain and what Health Canada was pushing on people. So a bit of an overview of modern plant genomics. The first plant genome sequence was done in 2000. And so this was actually done at the same time, essentially, as the human genome sequence, both of which took about 10 years to accomplish. Nowadays, especially in the past few years, we've had vast improvements in sequencing technology. And so this significantly reduces both the time and the economic cost of completing genome sequencing. In 2001, we published the cannabis genome sequence. So this was actually, they created an online browser called the Cannabis Genome Browser, which I'm going to do a brief demo of in a few minutes. But this is really a major step forward
and understanding what's actually inside the cannabis plant that makes it medicine. So the idea now in 2012 and 2013 is to get our hands on as many varieties of hemp, both high THC cannabis strains as well as fiber and seed oil strains, ruderalis strains, to try and sequence all of them and be able to analyze the specific diversity in all these strains. So here's the actual paper that was published, and some of the initial findings that they were able to kind of determine out of this is that the primary difference between the THC production is the expression of this one specific THC ACE and base gene. So that's pretty interesting. And it definitely provides a framework for future studies. So since then, there's already been a number of publications that have come out of this work using the genome data to analyze specific proteins and what they do. So what's next? Most of the time when we look at all these pictures, we're looking at the phenotype, and so that's essentially how a plant looks. The phenotype really is an expression of both the environmental conditions that a plant is grown in, as well as the genotype of that plant. Breeders have been really good at selecting phenotype. We're getting really good at determining what environmental conditions are necessary to grow the best cannabis. The genotype information is completely what's lacking, and that's where we come in. That's what we're trying to provide. So this allows you to annotate the genes, essentially determine what they are and what they do. We often do this by correlating it to the phenotype and proving the gene function experimentally by either knocking this gene out or changing the expression of it so that we can actually see what expressing this gene does to the plant. Also, because there's so many genome sequences available now in plants, we're able to compare this to other species and determine the differences between species and why cannabis is the way it is. But we can also compare within cannabis and see why specific strains have specific properties that they do. So really, this will allow a number of things. It will allow the selection of specific genes by breeders. It will provide increased speed of selection, and it will also enable the use of modern biotechnology, which they've been using in corn and rice and other agricultural property for a number of years now. So the idea is kind of to build this big phylogenetic tree. So here we've got all the different species of plants that have been sequenced, and you can see originally they used to take the phenotypic properties, so how a plant looks, and make these trees, and they've had to rehash them all since genome technology has come about, because now we compare the actual genetic code and are able to get a much better understanding of how individual species evolve. Our idea is essentially to do this within the cannabis family so that we can determine exactly where all of these fall and how they're related to each other. Arabidopsis is the model organism. It was essentially the first genome that they sequenced. And like cannabis, it was found all over the globe, and you see a number of different phenotypes essentially coming out of this. So they've been able to do this with this plant, sequence all these different genomes, and determine the exact genes that are essentially specific to the phenotypes that you see. Getting to the cannabis genome browser, so this is available online. You can just Google cannabis genome browser. The whole entire genome sequence is available for public download. It's about 90,000 Microsoft Word pages if you want to look at 90,000 pages of A, C, T's, and G's. Have fun with that. But if you are a scientist, you can actually start to use that information and go into things like the NCBI BLAST program. This is where you'd actually paste these sequences in and determine what they are. So I'm just going to do a quick little demo here and show you a bit of that. So here's what it looked like when you actually go to the website. Right here where it says download here, you can get the entire sequence, 90,000 or so pages. But really what this starts to show you is that we've been able to take individual scaffold sequences here and correlate them with a name and a function and start to determine exactly where these enzymes lie in a biochemical pathway. And so already they've got the precursor pathways as well as the actual production of THC and CBD quite well mapped out. And again, this is only published in 2011, so they're making progress quite quickly in this sort of thing. So you can also see the hemp phenola variety there. And just to confuse the hell out of you for a second, this is actually what the information for a geneticist would look like. It's showing all the different scaffold reads here. Yeah, pretty boring. But one thing you'll notice is we've already started to add new strains in here. So originally we had the Purple Kush and the Canola, and now they're starting to add in this USO31, which is a seed oil variety, as well as the Chem Dog. So our hope is really to expand this and put hundreds and hundreds of these strains in here so we can actually see what's different between them. So just some interesting studies. I found it kind of curious that Dr. Hornby was talking about apoptosis. Originally they took the THC gene and linked it to this expression gene called GFP, which just glows green inside the plant. And what you can see when THC is linked to GFP, it completely goes out into the glandular trichomes. It's actually not located inside plant cells at all. It's totally spit out into that glandular trichome, which obviously we've known for a long time, the trichomes are where the majority of the THC is held. But what's really interesting is when they tried to express this inside protoplast cells, which are essentially just plant cells floating in the media, it actually killed the cells. So THC is toxic to cells. And what they've found is at high concentration, it's toxic to insect cells, to fungus cells, to bacterial cells, and to plant cells, which is quite interesting, but also explains why it's excreted at high levels to the outside of the plant and not kept within the plant. It's essentially a very good defense mechanism molecule. It's going to keep away all your pests, but it attracts mammals, which are going to disseminate your seeds at the same time. So it's a very good molecule to have for a plant on an evolutionary scale. So here comes the fun stuff, getting into transgenic cannabis. Obviously, this is the inevitable next step. Whether we like it or not, people are going to make transgenic cannabis. I know pharmaceutical companies are already working on this. It is going to happen. The question is, when and who is going to do this? So yeah, transgenic means we're going to actually, rather than use a traditional plant breeding, you're going to specifically move genes around. And so you can see that kind of in the diagram. This green chunk of gene you're going to take out of the genome, you're going to stick it in this bacterial plasmid vector, use the vector to infect some calli cells, so essentially some cells growing on the media, and from there you can actually repopulate a plant, which I'll show in 1 second. So unlike the traditional plant breeding where we mix two genomes together and hope we get what we want, this actually allows the specific selection and movement of individual genes in a controlled fashion, which is an interesting thing. I'll get into some of the possible uses of this in a few minutes. But so far, calli regeneration, so that this is essentially one of the major steps in this process, is being able to propagate plants from a few number of cells that have been infected with this bacterium. This has been accomplished, and they're getting very well at it, as I'll show in a minute. Genes of interest, as I mentioned, are now being identified, so genes that might potentially be useful to us, we're starting to find now that we have the genome sequence. Transformation and regeneration has not been reported in the scientific literature. However, if you look online, you can find that it seems some obscure grad students have actually done this, maybe without their professors knowing. But there's definitely some images online of transgenic cannabis glowing in colors. So I don't know whether they're real or not, or just some Photoshop, but it's kind of interesting that they're close. And I actually expect within the next year that you'll see scientific literature on transgenic cannabis. And it has many, many applications. I'll get into a few just in a second here. So regeneration for calli, essentially what you do is cut a little chunk of tissue, put it on one media, and transfer it to another type of media, and this is going to induce shoots to form. You can then transfer it to another media, which has a different hormone combination, and this is going to make roots to form. Originally in cannabis, this is very difficult to do. Now they have some synthetic sort of hormone elicitor molecules, such as this TDZ, which is a cytokinin mimic. And you can see the calli percentage up in the 90% now. So that's extremely good. So obviously there's the debate here. Is GMO technology good or bad? To me, it's a technology. GM is a tool. It's not good or bad either way. It's the use and the purpose which determines whether it's good or bad. The example I like to use is nuclear. When Einstein split the first atom, he didn't think that they're going to drop a bomb as the first application. But now we have power plants, which are pretty safe and determined, you know, to be a relatively good use of the technology. They can get even more simple, though, and think of, like, your common knife. People don't think of a knife as good or evil. It's how you use it. If you cut vegetables, the knife is not bad. But if you kill someone with it, it's, you know, probably not a good thing. So to me, GM is exactly the same thing. It's a tool that can be used either way. So far, there's definitely been an increased rate of GM use in agriculture, and this is because it provides benefits to the farmers. Farmers aren't scientists. If they grow something and it provides an economic benefit to them that doesn't hurt their families and is healthy, they're going to keep using it. And that's really what we're seeing happening. Unfortunately, there's been a lot of regulations involved in the GM process, a lot of backlash against it, which is understandable because essentially a lot of big corporations have used it to sell more pesticides and chemicals. Still to date, there's no evidence that the GM technology itself actually has any adverse health effects. Essentially, a gene is a gene, and how it was put in that plant should be irrelevant. The fact of the matter is that we need to evaluate them all individually. If you're putting an insect gene inside of a plant, it's probably not the same as moving an endogenous gene that was already in that plant around and changing its expression level. It's completely different and should be evaluated differently. Lumping all GM in one category is essentially been a big problem for the GM crops that are going to help people because of the cost of getting through the regulatory process now. Only large corporations have benefited so far from GM laws. The only GM crops that are certified in North America are pesticide and herbicide GM. So at the same time, we've got vitamin A and golden fortified rice, which could be in Africa saving hundreds of thousands of lives a year, but is not certified because of the $500 or so million that it's going to require to get it through the testing and efficacy procedures. As a result, it's now been associated with one of these large companies because that was the only way for the scientists to actually get through that process was to align themselves with a big corporation. Really, it's hurting the little guy, and we're seeing the same sort of thing in all sorts of industries. So, so it's an interesting question. My opinion is, again, we need to evaluate them all individually as to their merit and intent. One application for GM technology in cannabis, which I think is very viable and probably has no negative characteristics, is the autoflowering trait. So you see all these autoflowering strains, which are nice because they're small and produce fast, and so for a lot of growers with limited space or time, this is really an important trait. In plants, you have four conserved flowering pathways: the day length, vernalization, or cold temperature, gibberellin, which is a plant hormone, or the autonomous. Essentially, most plants will flower after a certain amount of time anyways. The cannabis ruderalis strain, though, grows at a really high northern latitude and has a short season, so this is what causes it to induce the autoflowering trait. However, it is not a very potent strain, and so when you cross it to a strong THC strain, typically the F1 is reduced by half or less than half. And so it requires a number of multiple generations of back crossing and selection to get these autoflowering traits with a high THC content. And that's kind of a problem for breeders. With modern biotechnology, you can identify this single gene and move it around in a very controlled and precise fashion. You could create autoflowering strains and high THC strains without reducing the potency at all. And also, there's lots of precise control mechanisms where we can use inducible systems or lots of things where you could actually spray a chemical or a hormone on the plant and tell it to flower exactly now. So there's many benefits to this. Further applications are simple mutations. A lot of the agricultural crops are just mutants in a single gene, which cause beneficial phenotypic traits. THC hemp-free varieties for farming. Right now, farmers in Canada have to test their fields repeatedly, and if a single THC plant is found in there, they're usually in some big trouble. And so this is a significant cost to the farmer and has been kind of detrimental in a lot of people taking this up in the agriculture community. As we were talking, standardization and tailor-made strains, I think this is really the future. And it's kind of a two-sided coin where people were talking, do we want genetic diversity or do we want genetic specificity? I think it's the diversity is essential for creating the specificity, but from Health Canada's perspective, they want a standardized medicine. And some people, again, may want a high CBD strain with no THC. And we can really tailor make these strains, start to create them in a fashion that's very specific to the disease. And I think the whole issue of the red pill, blue pill is a really strong issue, especially when it comes to a pharmaceutical in Health Canada. They want something standard, and if you can go in and say, I want this strain for my cancer, I want this strain for my pain, I want this strain for my epilepsy, that's going to be a significant step forward to being able to legitimize this as a standard medicine. And I think it's not only the way that things will go, but probably the way they have to go. There's also terpenes. These are some interesting molecules. It's typically the aromatic scent molecules in cannabis, which have been shown to have some properties. And you can see companies like Greenhouse Seeds starting to list the terpene content as well. There's been some reports, not necessarily scientific, but some things that I've read on the internet about autistic children eating high terpene strains, and they find that the THC difference, it isn't what's causing them to respond. It's actually probably these aromatic terpene molecules. So I'm not necessarily recommending feed high THC strains to children, but it may be interesting to knock the THC out and use replacements, different strains for treatments, to replace drugs like Ritalin or all these things that seem to be pushed on kids a lot these days. And really what they've done in agriculture is primarily focus on stress tolerance, cold, drought, and insect resistance. These things we can definitely also provide to the cannabis plant. And they're getting really good at controlling expression, so we have tissue-specific expression. You can actually go in and transgenically change the expression of genes, but keep that in the leaves, or say only in the flowers, only in the roots, or have inducible systems where, like I was mentioning, you can take something like ethanol or estrogen and you give your plant a mist, and all of a sudden that gene will be kicked in and activated like a light switch, and you can really control how things are happening inside the plant. So this is really some of the amazing uses that modern biotechnology could provide. I'm happy to take any questions. I just want to thank the collaborators, University of Toronto, Saskatchewan, the NRC Plant Biotech Institute, Nova Scotia, and I was at the University of Guelph, so you can really see this kind of a cross-Canada collaboration, across Canada, and we're hoping that we'll do really well with this in the next year. I want to thank Marco and the Treating Yourself staff for inviting me to come, and Greenhouse Seeds, who gave us a nice leg up by providing their entire collection for sequencing right away. Please contact me for any further information on this crazy stuff. Thank you very much. Happy to take questions.
All right, do we have any questions for Dr. Hepp?
What's your opinion on the future of, easy-based privatization? Pfizer gets their hands on the cancer DNA genetics, and they get the patent on it, so they're the exclusive right to cancer, cannabis, wherever they decide.
Yeah, I'm completely against big pharma. So the whole idea behind this project is to make all this genome information publicly available so that the breeders can do what they want with it. We know big pharma has sequenced cannabis already. We know they are honing in on genes. But we've already kind of given a big kick in the ass by putting all these genes out there because they're publicly available now. It's going to be very difficult for them to patent things that are already out there. And when it comes to genetics, you're not allowed to patent a gene. You're allowed to patent the process. So the process of them modifying that gene or using it for biochemistry, they can patent. But again, by providing this information to the breeders, we feel that the breeders will take it and run with it. They'll do what they do best, and they'll breed the best cannabis strains by being able to, rather than select for phenotype, select for the individual genes that are responsible for that phenotype. And it's going to add a lot of power to what they do. I think, big pharma, big tobacco, they're both interested in this. We know that. Are they sequencing it and making it public? Obviously not. They're keeping that for proprietary reasons.
No, it's their point. It gets into the obviously.
Sorry?
You might be the next on the list because if you're basically showing off how to get these GMA crosses done for yourself, if you will. But now obviously these pharmaceuticals that are trying to get patent GMA for themselves to be able to market them as specific strains to their companies will not want that data, an open source database. So I'm just thinking outside the box, that might try to shut you down. So future breeders can actually have access to that database Once the DNAs are basically split across, people can actually modify their own or whatnot. You're probably already there. I'm just saying, you know, you've already been doing it.
Yeah, you're going to see transgenic cannabis, and I think you're going to see it out of major corporations. My fear is that only big pharma will come out with a very few select specific strains, and they'll certify it through Health Canada, and you'll be stuck with what they give you, and that'll be it. I don't think that that's the way. I think when you look at big pharma, when you go in to buy Tylenol or aspirin, there's, you know, your generic brand, your store brand, your certified brand. I think that's the way it should be. You need to walk into a pharmacy and have selection, not be told this is the only thing that you can have. And I think the only way to avoid that is to get all the information public and get it out as soon as possible.